39. There's a couple things about this chapter that stand out, obviously. This is Joseph. It's back to Joseph now. Remember last week we took a, it was a parenthetical with Tamar and Judah. As we come back now to Joseph, it starts to show us the testing, the temptations, the trials that we go through. And I want you to realize this as you study this chapter. There's seven things that really I want you to see as we go through it. And mark it down as you come across them. When Satan brings temptation, it's different than just ordinary temptations. And when I say ordinary, we all go through ordinary things, like we get agitated and irritated. We all go through the ordinary things of, disagreements with people, that kind of thing. But there are times when Satan outright attacks. And what Satan is doing here, outrightly attacking Joseph, is because Joseph is the protector of his people. How much does Satan know? I get this all the time. Why did Satan go after Joseph so much? Did Satan know that Joseph was going to be the one? I can't answer that for you. I don't think any human being can. But it is obvious that his life, he went through trials and temptations, but all of the things that he went through brought him to a culmination point of maturity and growth where he could be used of God and used by God. Amen. The same way as it is in our life. Everything we go through brings us to a place of maturity, spiritual maturity, where we can handle things, just like what Patsy is going through, to handle things that otherwise, previously in our life, would be twice as devastating. And so we go through these things to mature us and to grow us. But when you come to an outright Satan attack, how many of y'all have ever had a satanic attack? It overwhelms your mind, overwhelms your body, overwhelms your spirit, your peace. You feel, when I go through a spiritual attack, the first thing I want to do is go to sleep. I want to just go away and go to sleep. And I don't want to deal with anything. It's the ostrich head in the sand deal, right? A lot of people are like that. Some people get angry. They want to fight. But you can't fight and beat Satan, right? But we don't yield to him either. We resist him. And he'll flee from us. We talked about that before. So we don't wrestle with the devil. Remember that whole scripture? We wrestle not against flesh and blood, but principalities and powers. The whole purpose of that is to teach us to stop wrestling. Stop wrestling, because when you put the armor of God on, you're not equipped to wrestle, you're equipped to stand and fight. And so we need to stand and fight the good fight. Don't fight the devil, fight the good fight. There's a difference. And so when you're fighting the devil, you're so focused on the devil that you might injure those innocent ones around you. But when you're fighting the good fight, you know that what you are doing is you're edifying others, you're praying for others, you are doing that intercessory prayer, you're telling people the truth, you're planting the seeds, you're watering the seeds, you're living a godly life. And the more you do that, the stronger God is in your life, the weaker Satan is in your life. You're fighting the good fight. Fighting the good fight is an automatic fight against Satan. And the whole time you're fighting that good fight, you're getting stronger. You're getting bolder. You're getting better in Christ. Does that make sense? And so this is Joseph's life. Even though he didn't have all the tools that we have, he didn't have the indwelling Holy Spirit, he didn't have the written Word of God, he had a knowledge that he grew up with. He had an understanding. Plus, he had God with him. God was leading. God was guiding, even when Joseph didn't see it. And by the way, God is leading and God is guiding even when we don't see God in our life. So Satan, sometimes he will bring us temptations and he'll bring us trials. When he does, they are precise things. It's a precision attack. It is to keep you defeated. It is to destroy your confidence in the Lord. It is to destroy your confidence in your future. Folks, listen, this life is not the best there is. we get to leave this world, and then we have our best life, right? So stick that in your pipe and smoke it there, Joel Osteen. But Satan's attacks are precise. He knows how to get you. He knows how to damage you. He knows how to injure you. And so think about Joseph. Remember we talked about the fact that he had had those dreams? Those dreams came from God, didn't they? His brothers didn't like it. The devil used his brothers to get him in that pit. Please don't ever forget that. The devil used his brothers, but God used the devil to use his brothers to get to the final outcome. God can take a crooked stick and draw a straight line with it. God allowed the devil to do what he did. Don't ever misunderstand that. It's happening now. It happens in our life. There's nothing going to happen to you that God does not know about nor allow. Nothing. Amen. We are His children, washed in His blood, sealed by His Spirit, indwelt by His Spirit, and there is nothing that comes to us that God does not allow. Amen. And when we understand that in everything, not because of everything, but in everything, we can give thanks unto the Lord, because the Lord's good. It's the will of God in Christ Jesus. And so as we establish that, as we stand on that, as we stand on the truths of that, we are diminishing Satan's power in our life and diminishing Satan's power in people's lives around us, because we are showing the truth of God's word and the power of God's presence. Get that? And so then the next thing is that Satan will bring you not just a precision thing, whatever it is, it's going to get you. And as we talked about with Joseph, think about the pride that he had. He did display some pride, didn't he? Yeah, some a little bit of arrogance, a little bit of pride. And his dad made him a special coat because his dad loved him more than everybody else. I'm sure there was some pride in that young man. And God can't use a prideful person. God uses broken people. If you ever ask God, God, please use me, hang on. Because God is going to allow you to be touched by things that are going to hurt you and harm you. I never will, and this is personal. I never will forget, I was sitting in an old-fashioned tent revival. It was in August or September in 1994. Might have been 94. I was sitting in that tent revival, and the preacher was preaching, and he was preaching on, "Who shall go? Here am I, send me." And he preached on, you know, that the people are lost. They're blinded by Satan. They needed the gospel and all kinds of scripture that was used. And the Lord was speaking to me as if I was the only person sitting in that place. And it wasn't an audible voice. It was much louder than that. And that is, I'm calling you. You're going to preach. You're going to proclaim. And I was scared to death. But I said, Lord, if that's what you want me to do, I'll do what you want me to do. But it took me a long time to tell anybody. Then later, after I did tell somebody and the calling was evident on my life, I said, Lord, whatever it takes, I want to be used of you. Well, the Lord put me through a lot of heartache and a lot of pain. And I should have known that, because the day I got saved, I told the Lord that night, I said, Lord, I'll do whatever you want me to do. I'm yours. And I told the Lord, I said, I just want to be used. Whatever it takes for me to be used, Lord, use me. Whatever it takes. That was right after I got saved. The next, I forget the timeline exactly, few weeks, I was in traction for a year. God broke my body. All I could do was lay in that traction and read the Bible or watch TV. And you only watch so much TV and you get bored, and you only read so much and you get a headache. And I prayed a lot. And I learned more in that brokenness. Then when the Lord called me to preach, I went through another brokenness. I told the Lord I'd do whatever, I'd give up anything. I thought, I'll keep my real good job and I'll preach over here, and that way I can preach for free wherever somebody wanted me to, and I have a job to take care of me. That's what I thought. And then I lost my supervisor job. I lost it. Now, it worked out to my advantage. I'm sure I told you that. But all through the years when I've prayed, Lord, I want to be more like you. I hate me. I want to be more like you. There's pain that comes my way. There's loss. There's brokenness. Somebody close to me passes. I get sick. I get broken. I get down. I lose something of value. It happens every time. God allows it. And God does it in a roundabout way to make us more usable. Because God can't use somebody that's prideful and arrogant. And He can't use people that are relying on their own strength. He uses people that have no strength but His strength. And if we understand that, then when things come into our life, as the devil brings those precision things and the devil brings those painful things, then I want you to know we can still stand for God. The third way that the devil tried to get Joseph, and he'll try to get you, is pleasure. Remember Potiphar's wife? Have you read this chapter before? If not, we'll get into it this week and next week. Potiphar's wife. It's a promise of pleasure. Who would have known? He would have had it on his conscience, and God would have known. And he had integrity. He had determined to have integrity. Is everybody with me? But the devil offered him pleasure. That was a temptation. Do you think God did not know that was going to happen? Do you think God did not allow that to happen? Yes, God allowed that to happen. And yet Joseph stayed true. Think about your own life. How many times have you been tempted to do something that may have been your old character before you got saved, but then all of a sudden you realize that's the devil tempting you, and you're going to stand for Jesus. Anybody ever have that happen? I used to steal everything that wasn't nailed down. When I was lost, everything. That's why I didn't have a whole lot of friends, because I'd just steal it. And after I got saved and God had changed me, I was at a gun show. I told AJ this. I was at a gun show, and the guy had taken a pistol out, laid it on the counter, and somebody else was looking at it, laid it down, walked away. There was nobody there. And I walked by and saw it. The first thing that came through my mind was, you could take that, nobody'd ever know. And then I got sick. I got sick. Because I said, oh, where did that come from? That was a temptation from the devil to be the old me. So I called the guy. I said, hey, mister, you got a gun laying out here and somebody's liable to steal it. He said, oh, thank you. I didn't know it was out there. And he put it back in the cabinet. Success! But don't think for a minute the devil didn't tempt me, but God didn't allow it. You see. And say I'd failed, and then I'd have got caught, it would have ruined my testimony. It would have ruined everything, wouldn't it? Yeah. And so you got to be alert. But the devil will bring these precise things, these painful things, even pleasure things. Then he'll also bring persuasive things. He'll try to persuade you that your way of thinking is right and everybody else is wrong. Or he'll try to persuade you that everybody's against you. There are some people that can't just stand up and live. They think that everybody hates them. You run across people like that, right? And everybody's against them. Everybody hates them. They are under an attack. That is an attack of Satan. Because that's not the reality. The reality is there's a handful of people probably hate your guts. Because you got a handful of people, you hate their guts too. Yep. Am I right or am I wrong? Is there not somebody in your life you'd like to slap the taste out of their mouth? Yes. Well, you're one of somebody's too. It is humanity. But the devil knows that and he's going to use that. Everybody with me, right? So there's persuasion, there's persistence. And I want you to know this. When Satan is tempting you, he's patient. Satan's patient. and he knows we're not. Now, Joseph, how did he get Joseph there? I mean, how was he trying to get Joseph? How long was Joseph in prison? And then, am I ever going to get out of here? It was patience. But what happens is, the devil's more patient than we are. And what happens is, then we try to find our own way out of the problem, our own way out of the issue, instead of being patient and allowing the Lord to work as well. Because the Lord is more patient than the devil is. He's got an eternity. The devil has a short time. And then the last way that the devil tempts you is when you're all alone in the privacy of your mind. I can't imagine being Joseph, and as he sits there, how much anger he must have against his brothers for so many years. How much anger, how much bitterness, how much hatred. I mean, think about it. He goes into Pharaoh's house, right? We don't see him acting like a Jew at all. We don't see him acting like his family at all. He changed his dress. He changed everything. He didn't want nothing to do with them guys. Until all of a sudden they were in front of him. And then we're going to find out he remembers that dream. He remembers all that. And God meant it for good, even though his brothers meant it for evil. Right? And so keep that in mind. The devil will tempt you, and we're going to see these things over the next 2 weeks as we study this. All right, let's begin in verse number 1. And Joseph was brought down to Egypt, and Potiphar, an officer of Pharaoh, captain of the guard, an Egyptian, bought him of the hands of the Ishmaelites, which had brought him down thither. And the Lord was with Joseph, and he was a prosperous man, and he was in the house of his master, the Egyptian. Now, let me stop right there. So just so that you know, we're talking about Potiphar. I threw it out a little bit last week. Potiphar isn't a name. It's not Mr. and Mrs. Potiphar here. The word Potiphar is an Egyptian word that has the idea of the master over or the Lord over. And so what Potiphar was historically in Egypt, he was in charge of the military forces that surrounded the castle. So understand, he wasn't in charge of the armies that went out to do battle, but the household, the castle, would have had its own soldiers. And so he was responsible. He was the captain of the guard, so to speak, the home guard, and he had his own military force under him. That military force was never allowed inside of the home. All the work with the military force, and you'll understand in a minute, all the military work had to be done outside of the home, outside the wall of the home. They could do nothing inside or in close proximity of. And the reason is because the second thing, he was in charge of the harem. Potiphar was in charge of Pharaoh's harem. And so a Potiphar would have one end of the house, and each of the women would have their own room, or there would be several in one room. And so as the Pharaoh would desire a woman, he would pick one, or he would have Potiphar pick one or a dozen or whatever and send to his room. So there would be one whole wing of the castle that's nothing but the harem, the king's harem, or in this case, Pharaoh's harem. The third thing he was in charge of was the household servants. The men, they were all eunuchs. They were all castrated males. In order to serve inside the castle, if you were a male, you had to be circumcised. I mean, castrated. Yeah, not circumcised. That was a Jewish thing. So you had to be castrated, which is worse than circumcision, okay? Just so you know. And you'll get that later. Anyway, so they're all castrated males. And the reason being, the harem down the hall. The reason the soldiers are never allowed in the house, the harem down the hall. So the Potiphar, when a man became a Potiphar, he was second in command to Pharaoh. The only time you see somebody second in command to Pharaoh who wasn't circumcised is going to be Joseph, which is an awesome thing. All right? That shows you how much trust Pharaoh had in Joseph. That's how much integrity and character this man displayed his entire life. So Potiphar, to be the second in command, to be the one who's in charge of the household, he would have voluntarily castrated himself. And so he would have been a prominent soldier. He might have been a general of an army, but he's going to get more money. It's a prestigious position. But there's one catch. You've got to castrate yourself to prove your allegiance to Pharaoh and to have that job. Stop and think about that. All right? Everybody got that? Doesn't the whole thing with Mrs. Potiphar make sense, right? And so here's Potiphar. He's in charge of the forces, he's in charge of the harem, and he's in charge of the eunuchs. Notice what happens. He's brought down to Egypt. Potiphar, an officer of Pharaoh, captain of the guard, an Egyptian, bought him of the hands of the Ishmaelites. Now notice this. This is important. He did not buy him to serve inside of the castle. He bought him to serve himself. Potiphar would have had his own place with Mrs. Potiphar and the Potipharites before he was a castrated male. And so he would have been bought as just a young male slave. Now, what were young male slaves used for? Because people ask me this a lot. They were mostly used to work the land, to raise cattle. They were used to cut the firewood. They were used for whatever physical necessities there were outside the home. Usually, the males weren't allowed in the home to serve in the home until they were elderly or if they were also castrated for obvious reasons, right? And so it was not normal for the men who worked in the field and so forth to be brought in the home. The only reason for them to ever be in the home was to bring in something that was heavy, the wood for fires, cooking fires, stuff of that nature. Everybody with me? All right. So a lot of information here, but it'll make sense in a little bit. Verse 2, this is important. And the Lord was with Joseph. The Lord was with Joseph. Now, when the Lord is with you, folks, you have the Master's hand upon you. Amen. You are favored. It means that he was favored. And so think about this for just a minute. How many of you know people that just the hand of the Lord is upon them? Amen. You just sense it, you feel it, you see it. You're around them. Joe, your son, is one of those people. The Lord is with Joe. You can tell it. You can feel it. You can hear it, right? And it makes no rational sense, but God chooses to do that. And so Joseph here was like that. He was a prosperous man, which meant that everything he did, he prospered. So the slaves were allowed portions of what they prospered their owners in. So the more prosperous a slave was, the better his living conditions, the better clothing he could have, the better food he have, and all that. Makes sense, doesn't it? And so Joseph went from being the favorite son of his father, who didn't seem to do a whole heck of a lot of work. His brothers did all the work. He just walked around in his fancy coat. Am I right? Yeah. And so he just walked around doing whatever his dad told him to do, wearing his fancy coat. And so he was not accustomed to as much work as this is. So he finds himself sold into Egypt, into Potiphar's house, and he's working, he's serving. What he does, the Lord is with him, the Lord blesses his work, and he gets favor from the household. This is important because this is probably why he was allowed to come inside to start with. So here we go. He was in the house of his master, the Egyptian. And not meaning the house, but it's in his property. Okay? Verse 3, still there? So notice this. You can't hide when God favors you. His master saw that the Lord was with him. Now he didn't acknowledge, this isn't saying that he acknowledged God, but he saw that he was a favored man. The Egyptians would have said, the gods favored him, right? And so they saw that there was something special about him and that the Lord made all that he did to prosper in his hand. And Joseph found grace in his sight and he served him and he made him overseer over his house, and all that he had, he put into his hands. So stop. So what is the traditional custom? If you're going to have the household put in your hand, which meant you had access to the wife, castration. Joseph had such a character, and the Lord had blessed him and favored him so much that it never was a contemplation of Potiphar to do that to this man. He fully trusted this man with everything in his house. Now think about that. Here was a man bought out of a pit who seemingly had nothing, who he bought and paid for, put into the field. Everything he touched just made Potiphar money. Potiphar saw he could be trusted. Potiphar saw that he would do the right thing, and he trusted him so much, he brought him inside the house to be the master of his household, just like Potiphar was for Pharaoh. And here's where the trouble begins, right? God was with him. And it came to pass from the time that he had made him overseer in his house over all that he had, that the Lord blessed the Egyptian's house for Joseph's sake, and the blessings of the Lord was upon all that he had in the house and in the field. The word overseer has the idea of to have the charge of, to be like the executive officer of, to make financial decisions. Now, you stop and think about that for just a minute. That's quite the honor, is it not? Most of us, if we were made slaves tomorrow, those poor people would rue the day they bought us. Am I right or am I wrong? Slave my hind leg. Go cut your own wood. And he left all that he had in Joseph's hand, and he knew not all he had. Isn't that interesting? He gave all of his wealth to Joseph, a man that started out in the pit. He trusted him so much, he gave him all his money and said, dude, you're better with money than I am. Here's all my money. You take it, invest it. I trust you. That's some trust. Save the bread, which he did eat. He gave him everything but the loaf of bread he ate. That's pretty important. And Joseph was a goodly person, not godly, but goodly, and well-favored. Well-favored by God, well-favored by his master, just a well-favored. Inside that little phrase, well-favored, also there is a connotation of health. So not only was Joseph blessed of God to be able to do things materially, but he also was a very strong, very healthy, very masculine young man, right? And so that's well-favored as well. And it came to pass, verse 7, that trouble comes, right? It came to pass after these things that his master's wife cast her eyes upon Joseph. And she said, lie with me. Notice that. There's a lust of the eyes. Then there comes a lust of the flesh. And remember, before you judge Miss Potiphar, Miss Potiphar was Miss Potiphar. Married to a man who castrated himself, who loved his position, loved his title more than he loved his wife. That's serious business. This woman was neglected physically, and so here was Joseph, who was well-favored. He's a handsome young man. He was a wealthy young man. He was just blessed. Everything he touched just turned to gold. And so her lust began. And then she conceived a plan and tried to get him to sleep with her. But he refused. That's awesome. He's also a young man. If you stop and think about it, he had more power than Potiphar. Because he had trumped Potiphar. Potiphar was under his rule. Voluntarily, because he gave him his wealth, he gave him his house. He was a castrated man. A castrated man will live subservient to other men, you see. And so he just paid, he was subservient. You get that, right? And so he refused and said unto his master's wife, "Behold, my master, what is not what is with me in the house? And he hath committed all that he hath to my hand." Hold on. My master has given me everything. Everything. I can't do this to him. He's a slave, remember? Even though he's well favored, even though he's well taken care of, he's still a slave. He can't just leave. He can't leave Egypt and go back home. He's still a slave, and yet he has integrity. You know, this is a serious test of integrity, and I don't think I'd do as well. Do you? We would want to. But man, there's temptations here. And hey, don't think for a minute that nobody would know. There you go. Unless she showed up pregnant. By the way, doesn't the Bible teach us that our sins will find us out? Yeah. You sow to the wind, you'll reap a whirlwind, right? Yes, it does. And they do find us out. Even if the public never finds out our sin, God found them out. We know them. We can't escape our memory. We can't escape our conscience, can we? We can sear it, but we can never escape it. He had real, genuine, honest to goodness integrity. This was a real godly man in a very bad situation. Although it was a good situation, still a bad situation. He says, "There's none greater in this house than I." That's a statement. I'm greater than he is. "There's none greater, neither hath he kept back anything from me." There's nobody greater than this house than me. And the man who owns it all gave it all to me. He held nothing back to me but you. You, and by the way, ladies, you're a sacred treasure. Your sacred treasure. This is, we don't understand this in our modern culture because we are so perverse. But sexual contact opens yourself up to a whole nother world. You truly are knit together. And it is supposed to be between husband and wife. And only between husband and wife. And it is a special bond. Now, Potiphar ruined that. Because Potiphar's bond was money, wasn't it? Doesn't the Bible say the love of money is the root of all evil? Well, obviously, Potiphar, whatever his real name was, he loved that title, he loved that money, he loved that position. And let's face it, he probably, at this stage of the game, he was probably in his mid to late 30s. And all he wanted was fame, fortune, and money. He didn't think about the consequences. You get that? So notice this, "Because thou art his wife, how then can I do this great wickedness and sin against God?" Let's stop. Let's look at Egyptian culture for just a minute. Egyptian culture. The Egyptian culture was a promiscuous culture. It was not unusual for promiscuity to take place. It was not unusual for adultery to take place. But what was unusual was for a woman to instigate it or initiate it. And the reason it's so unusual, it was normally a man thing. Even in our world, it still is it not, for the most part? Men go on the hunt, right? But this was very unusual. This woman had been deprived. This woman had been put on a back burner. This woman had been considered to be nothing. And she had been replaced by money and position. And all of a sudden now she saw her husband, who had replaced her with money and position, she saw her husband allowing this young man to replace him. This is a natural conclusion to the event. You're the man. I'm that guy's wife, but you're the man of the house. Here I am. Do you understand? Put the human element back in the Bible. And he said, "No, you're still his wife." Even though that husbandly function isn't there, you're still his wife. And I will not do this. Everything is given to me but you. And I will not do this thing. Oh, if we could have people like that today. So it came to pass, look at this, and notice this, nor can I do this great wickedness and sin against who? Yeah. There's only one greater than Joseph in the whole land, and that's not Pharaoh. Stop and think about it right here. Stop and think about it. So Pharaoh had given access unto his house by Potiphar. Potiphar had given access to his house and made Joseph greater than him in his house, which would have given access to Joseph into Pharaoh's house. Isn't that weird? And Joseph could have done whatever Joseph chose to do as a young man. He could have had whatever he wanted, done whatever he wanted, because he had put the other men in subservience to him, even as a slave. There is none greater than God. And the Egyptian culture, this is not a play on words. He's talking about Yahweh, God. The Egyptians saw Pharaoh as the supreme God. And then when Pharaoh died, God died and another God would raise up to take his place, his son or whomever. And then all the other demons, the little lesser gods, were subservient to him. So there's not a play on words. What he said was, I am not going to sin against the God who is above all gods, including Pharaoh. Which by that very statement, he is denying, he is rejecting Pharaoh as God, which puts himself above Pharaoh as a worshiper of the one and true God. Please understand this, people. You will not bow your knee to a false God. You will not bow your knee and worship a king or a leader as God. We are above every king. We are above every prince. We are above every power that's on this earth because we will not bow the knee to any man. We bow only to God. We are above them. We're all equal at the foot of the cross, us. But the us that are equal at the foot of the cross are far above. We are princes. Has everybody got that? And so we don't bow down to any other gods. So understand this is, and people, to understand what I'm saying, through the centuries have tried to make this a play on words, and some theologians, liberal theologians, have tried to downplay this and say that it was only his integrity that kept him from doing this and not that he knew the God of the Bible. That's a lie. Amen. Joseph knew the God of the Bible from his birth. His father, hey, he messed up a lot of stuff, but that man taught him about God. Y'all with me, right? Remember, he set up an altar. They prayed to God. They sacrificed to God. Joseph knew God. Now here he is. Everything's about to change. Now stop and understand this. Even though he's saved, even though he knows God, he's worshiping God, do you or do you not still see there is some pride? There's nobody greater than me. I'm the greatest. Like Muhammad Ali. Muhammad Ali got on an airplane one time, and he always called himself Superman. And the little light came on, sit down, buckle up, before that plane could take off. And he told the little stewardess came by, and she said, sir, you're going to have to buckle your seatbelt. He said, Superman don't need no seatbelt. She said, you're going to buckle that seatbelt. Superman don't need no seatbelt. She said, sir, Superman doesn't need an airplane. Now sit down, shut up, and buckle your seatbelt. That's good. That's good right there. Listen, there is still some pride in this young man. By the time we get to the end, all the pride is crushed. He becomes the true second in command by the time we're done. But there's not an ounce of pride in him. He's a broken man because he is longing for the things of God, the family of God, and his own family. I want you to realize this. I've seen this. We're going to stop right here. We're going to pick this up next week. I've seen this happen so many times. I've seen people who are coming to church. They're serving God. The Lord is the forefront of their minds. They're in love with the Lord. Then all of a sudden a business opportunity comes. Overtime comes. A new job that's going to take you away from church. And I've seen them go. And I've seen their spiritual life decline to the point they're just gone. I've seen it so many times. And folks, what is at the forefront of that? There's something that took God's place in your mind before it took God's place in your life. Now, that's not the case with Joseph, but there is pride in his life. So before God can use him to deliver his people, before the dream comes true, when they're in that room and all of his brothers are on their face before him, because that dream does come true, doesn't it? For him to sit there and go, "I'm the greatest in this room." He didn't do that, did he? He got on their level, spoke in their language. He wept and cried with them. He consoled them. And then he told them, "I'm one of you." He didn't try to make them one of him. Makes sense, doesn't it? Everything Joseph's going through, this young man had some pride. Before God could use him, there's some changing that had to happen. And the same way as it is in every one of our lives. You want to know the greatest place we're ever going to be used? It's not here on this earth. Well, not here this time on this earth. The greatest time we're going to be used is during the millennial reign. It will be on this earth, but we'll be in a glorified body. We're going to rule with the Lord. This world is not all going to be saved. The devil will be bound, and he'll be in hell for 1,000 years. And for that 1,000 years, what we're going to be doing is we're going to be working to do that restorative work, that building work, that protecting work of Israel and the restoration. We're going to be doing all that reconstruction. But it's going to be a good thing, a glorious thing. And then the devil's let loose. And the greatest work we will have will be when that devil is let loose. Because when that devil's let loose, he starts going around and getting people against Jesus. And our job, I believe fully with all my heart, is we're going to be protecting Israel. And we're going to be protecting those Jews. And they're all going to be back in their homeland, and the rest of the earth is going to be replenished. But the devil's going to do his work to try to come back against them again. And we're going to be used, but we couldn't do that now. The way we do it now is with bombs and guns and bullets and anger and hatred. We've got to be right to be used right. Then we get our eternal home. Makes sense, don't it? Yep. All right. Okay, so let's pray. Let's go home. Let's eat chicken and come back tonight.